Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Retno Puspitasari. I'm a teacher in SMN 53 Jakarta. So I want to share my experience is about the use of WhatsApp in my lesson. It relates with what I have watched also in the CMU lecture series. So actually, I have already used WhatsApp, especially the video call, in my first in my first meeting, so I asked my students to introduce themselves to the others in the video call, consists of six persons including me, and it really works because they can do the introduction well. And I think that's all. Thank you so much for the
Hi. My name is Asuba Elias Nur Adiba binti Ali from College Community Pasir Gudang, Johor, Malaysia. Thank you for let us join this interesting webinar, which is open to public. I enjoy participating in this webinar. I see the CMO Secretariat and participating organization choosing topics in various aspects for presentation was so solid and brilliant. Lots of sharing new knowledge I gain. Some seem simple, but technically need solid foundation to handle it, like autoproctor, and a lot of new knowledge skills given in discussed in the presentation. This webinar, which is Innovative Teacher Education in the New Normal, presenting on 13 August 2020, is potential to help us to adapt our situation through this pandemic COVID-19. I hope education and technology will continue evolving and developing fast together with this effort. Thank you very much. You are the best.
Hi, CMO. Thank you for the opportunity in joining the online lectures. Actually, this helped me a lot, especially when it comes to online learning. There are new technology, as well as software and website that we can use in our online class or to include in our online class. What I really love in this lecture now or the webinar is the autoproctor, which is I think this will be very helpful in conducting online quizzes and online exams. So this helped me, this will help me a lot in checking and then the of course the trust rating of my my students. Okay, so that's all. I hope to see more videos or a webinar series from you. Thank you.
Hi, Zimeo. Good afternoon. I just want to say thank you for the video or the webinar that you provide for us. This video is very helpful in online learning. Now that we are facing the pandemic crisis, this is what we need. I really liked the lecture. Actually, there are 15 lectures that you provide. But what catches my attention is the one that how we can use the Facebook for our classroom. Another one is how we can give tests to our students using the Google Time Proctor features and the auto proctor. So this video is very helpful for us. And thank you very much. I am looking forward to watch the next video that you are going to provide next week. Thank you so much.
Mabuhay! This is Vance Manitis Bernardino from the Philippines. First of all, I would like to extend my deepest gratitude and congratulations to Sineo for successfully conducting this kind of webinar series. Although I am not a teacher yet, but I'm a student of professional teaching certification and currently working as a science research analyst under the Department of Agriculture in the Philippines, I learned a lot of new ways and tools that I can able to use and adapt as we proceed on providing online trainings to the Filipino farmers, specifically the women-led entrepreneurs, because I myself involved in training and extension services. But because of this pandemic, we have to stop our face-to-face training. Thank you so much, Simeo. Because of you, I learned new ways and tools that I can able to adapt in order to sustain, to interact, and to connect with the Filipino farmers and women entrepreneurs of the country. And I will treasure all the ideas and new ways that I learned from you. Thank you so much.
Stand for our vicious alone, they live here. creating opportunities by working hand in hand we can accomplish all our dreams for a better quality of life is now within our reach.
Good morning from Southeast Asia, good afternoon and good evening for participants in all other regions. My name is Thu20Aug, I'm the Deputy Director of Senior Secretariat. I'd like to welcome you all to the third session of SEA-Teacher-TVET lecture series, live here from the headquarters of CBO Secretariat in Bangkok, Thailand. Let me share my presentation. This lecture series is one of CBO projects to keep learning continue in the time of difficulty due to COVID-19 pandemic. Four lecture sessions are provided in the month of August on each Thursday, and this is the third one in the series on the theme of teaching technology and agriculture in the new normal. Today, we will learn about different issues in various technology disciplines. Issue one is very important and it's imperative to learn this, since we are in the move toward the fourth industrial revolution. The six categories of lecture in this session are technology revolution, blended learning for mechanics, digital communication, AR integration, applied electronics, and modern agriculture. SEA-Teacher-TVET lecture series, it's a project under CBO 7 priority area, especially the priority area number 4 on promoting technical and vocational education and training. With SEA-Teacher, it's to provide opportunity for pre-service student teachers among universities in Southeast Asia to do their practicum, the teaching experience for 1 month in school in other countries in Southeast Asia. And SEA-TVET is to provide opportunity for TVET diploma, higher diploma, bachelor student, among TVET institutions in Southeast Asia to experience working with industry to internship program for one to three months in other countries in Southeast Asia. Well, when talking about the SEA-Teacher-TVET, the concept is the academic mobility. Academic mobility is an opportunity for a student or teacher to go study or teach in another institution outside of their own country for a certain time. For SEA-Teacher, the SEA-Teacher project has been established since 2015. The exchange of the pre-service student teacher is preferably for fourth-year students whose major are in math, in science, English, and preschool. The duration, as I mentioned before, is for 1 month. Students' role and responsibility are assigned weekly during the 1 month period. This involves observing, assisting in teaching, and also reflection. Moreover, the host university will provide mentors to supervise and monitor the students throughout the practical period. Apart from countries in Southeast Asia, this year we also have Japan joining SEA-Teacher as well. For SEA-Teacher, the journey began since 2018 until present. The technical and vocational education and training is to promote student exchange, staff exchange, cross-country industrial attachment, internship program, and also research collaboration. Student exchange will be performed by TVET institution. The number and the duration will be decided by participating school, college, or polytechnics. Ideally, the minimum duration for student exchange is 1 month to 3 months, or even 1 year. But considering various school capacity and institution may have shorter duration of student exchange. The priority area, a lot of priority area in engineering, IT, multimedia, business and hospitality, agriculture, food technology, nursing, and public health. Apart from a pre-service student teacher, we also expand to TVET teacher as well. The priority area of the TVET teacher exchange is engineering, IT, business, agriculture, and education, and still expanding. It started in 2020 with 55 institutions participating. But due to COVID-19 pandemic, the 2020 program has been postponed to next year. The SEA-Teacher and SEA-TVET student exchange starting from 55 students with the 2012 institution, it's growing up until 542 students and with 90 institutions. This year, it's coming to 143 institutions. But that's supposed to postpone to the next year of 2021. For today's lecture series, apart from the 11 lectures we have selected from around 30 submissions, we are glad to have a special guest joining us to provide us with special lecture on teaching computer science online during COVID-19. We are honored to have our guest, Andy Lee. This is the president of Innovation First International from Hong Kong. And he will introduce you with his equipment and his learning material that you can use online. You can control the robot online using web-based system. Before we proceed to our lecture today, let me introduce our team who will guide you to the sequence of the knowledge. We have in our studio our two experts, Ms. Diepa and Mr. Rafi. So let's switch the camera to our CMO studio in Bangkok, Thailand, and hope you all enjoy our lecture series today. Thank you very much. Sawasdee krab.
Okay. Okay, a pleasant morning to all our viewers on YouTube. We have 521. Diepa, let us meet them.
Hi, good morning, everyone. Diepa is here and nice to see you again.
So today is Thursday, another CMU lecture series Thursday. So we'll be having a number of videos and we'll start with a guest lecture. So the guest lecture will be about teaching computer science online during COVID-19 from Mr. Andy Lee, the president of IFI Hong Kong. So let's enjoy this lecture.
Yeah, sure.
Greetings, I'm Andy Lee, president of Innovation First International Hong Kong Limited, and I'm really excited to be speaking with you today about the topic of how to teach computer science online and remotely. What we've seen during this pandemic is, bar none, the most difficult period of time that most of us have faced in modern memory. But what we'd like to discuss a little bit is some of the solutions that we've come up with of how to teach computer science with our new software called VexCode VR. It's a brand new virtual robotics coding simulator. First, just to share a little bit about Vex Robotics, we're an educational robotics developer of software, curriculum, and hardware that's used in classrooms all around the world. We also have the world's largest robotics tournament every year. One of our key strengths is that we offer a very easy entry point for educators to get started in teaching coding and robotics, and that we can scaffold to a much higher level. We also have developed robotics programming software that will allow novices to learn how to code and transition from block type programming to text programming. And we also have software for advanced programmers to customize and unlock their programming potential. These systems are supported with standards aligned curriculum and online support resources. We also have online courses and certification for teachers, and you can complete those via self-study. VETS Robotics has different levels of robotic systems for primary, secondary, and university students. The ultimate test for many students is to design, build, and code a robot to solve one of our annual robotics challenges. So now that you know more about VETS Robotics and our resources, I'm really excited to talk to you today about VETS Code VR. VETS Code VR is web-based. There's no software installations required. The link is vr.vex.com, which is in the top right-hand corner here. And you can type that into your browser and look at the website as we discuss it during today's webinar. VETS Code VR works on all major desktops and tablet browsers. PC, Mac, Chromebook, iPads, all can access VR through a browser. If you look at the website, you may recognize it's a familiar user interface. VETS Code VR is based on Scratch Blocks programming software. It's the same programming environment that you would use for many platforms, including VETS 123, Go, IQ, and V5 robots. So let's have a look at the virtual robot that's used in VR. In VR, the robots are pre-built, and this is meant to provide an even platform for the students to get started in. The robot has a drivetrain with four wheels and two motors to navigate the numerous virtual playgrounds. Within the virtual robot, there's a built-in gyroscope and location sensor. There's two eye sensors. There's one that is forward-facing and there's one that's downward-facing to detect colors and the distance to objects that are colored. There are bumper sensors to help solve the virtual mazes and challenges, a left and a right one. And there's also a pen feature that allows you to program your robot to code and draw on the art canvas playground to make a creative drawing. Last but not least, there's an electromagnet to interact with metal game objects in certain virtual challenges. So let's move to the actual website and let's have a look at the interface. We'll be walking you through the layout so that you can navigate around it. So on vr.vex.com, this is the main area where you'll be building the code in the center of the screen. What you can do on the left-hand side in the toolbox has all the different commands. So I can drag over different commands and I can start coding. Now, from the left-hand side, you can see at the top that there's different languages. We have different ways that you can, there's a standard file menu for saving and opening up programs. There's integrated tutorials and basics like activities, which allow you to go to our education site and learn from some of the different activities. In the central box, you can name your project when you need to save or download your project. Then there's a virtual playground button, which brings up this particular map. And this is the cool feature that really makes it exciting for the student to be programming in a virtual environment. We can zoom out, we can zoom in and see our robot as it performs on this virtual field. So let's play this particular, let's execute the code on this particular program and let's see what does it do. So if I were to press play, what we want the robot to do is drive forward for 200 mm and I can change the values and I can change the measurement, whether it's millimeter or inches. And then I want it to turn right for 90 degrees. So I'm going to press play here. And as it's executing the code, what you can see is that there was green highlights highlighting what did it do and at what stage of the program that the robot is performing. At the top here, you can expand or you can hide the playground. The panel right here, is you have some more statistics. You have an information panel that allows you to see the heading of your robot. And it's got some useful data with 0 degrees, meaning north. Rotation is the rotational value and it's a cumulative value. Then we have the various sensors, the front eye and the down eye. We can measure distance and color. And with the down eye, we can measure or detect if there's an object and what color that object is. Next, we have the location of the robot on the X and Y axes. The current location of the robot right now is minus 900 mm by minus 900 mm. Each square in this field is 200 mm by 200 mm. And the center of the field is 0, 0. Some more statistics, we can see whether or not the bumper switch was pressed, the distance that the robot traveled. And we also have some other things and fun things that you can do with the different exercises. Now, last but not least is the ability that we can switch from the block type programming and see what does that function look like? What did these commands look like in text, in Python? So if I were to drag over another command here, you'll see that it pops up on the right-hand side. And if I were to drag it and delete it, it would take it away from the Python project as well. So this is very useful information for students so that they can accelerate their learning. I'd like to thank you for joining us today and learning more about VexCode VR. If you have any questions, please do contact us. The email is in the lower right-hand corner. You can also contact us and follow us on Facebook as well as Twitter. So thank you very much. I'd like to thank you all and Simeo for giving us the opportunity to speak with you. Have a great day.
Okay, so we learned so much on teaching computer science online during COVID-19. So that our guest lecturer was able to walk us through the potentials in applying computer science online during these times. So now let's proceed to the selected lecture. So we have a number of lectures for this morning, and we will start with technological revolution in the post-COVID-19 world. So we will fly from Hong Kong to the Philippines and enjoy this lecture by Mr. Brian Dadis. So let's enjoy this lecture and learn.
Please.
Good morning, everybody. I am Mr. Brian G. Dadis, an assistant professor at the Technological Institute of the Philippines, Manila. I have been teaching computer science courses for the past 11 years in the College of Information Technology Education. My educational background is that I am a graduate of a bachelor's degree in computer science at the Technological Institute of the Philippines, Manila, 2009, and also master in information technology in 2012 at the same school. Presently, I am a PhD candidate taking up Doctor of Philosophy in Computer Science at De La Salle University, Manila. In this present day, amidst the events of this pandemic that changed the way all used to be, now face-to-face teaching is no longer possible and transition to online learning is the new wave of equipping students with the knowledge and skills they need for the industry. Learning should not stop, and adapting to this change is an essential skill that we all must possess. And this is the ultimate challenge that we all must overcome. I am here to teach the course Technological Revolution in the Post-COVID-19, and I would like to showcase the outcomes-based education methodology in delivering this lesson. Initially, let us discuss the description of the course. The technological revolution in the post-COVID-19 is about the technologies that emerge from being casual to now trending technologies. These technologies aim to sustain the workforce of many industries and effortlessly continue the course of work in these post-COVID times. In this course, topics such as digital payments, telehealth, and robotics will outline the topics. Moreover, the notable technologies will also be tackled in response to mitigating the spread of the virus. The primary intended learning outcomes that the students will be learning after the discussions are: describe the different technology trends such as digital payments, telehealth, and robotics that can help build a resilient society. Explain the technologies that can help reduce the spread of the coronavirus while helping the business stay explain the different technologies that can help society more resilient in the face of pandemic and other threats. Technological Revolution in the Post-COVID-19 by Brian Daddies. Intended learning outcomes. Describe different technology trends such as digital payments, telehealth, and robotics that can help build a resilient society. Explain the different technologies that can help society more resilient in the face of pandemic and other threats. So for this lesson, our objective is to discuss the online shopping and robot deliveries, digital and contactless payments, remote work. Digital and contactless payments. Cash might carry the virus, so central banks in China, US, and South Korea have implemented various measures to ensure banknotes are clean before they go into circulation. Now, contactless digital payments, either in the form of cards or e-wallets, are the recommended payment method to avoid the spread of COVID-19. Digital payments enable people to make online purchases and payments of goods and services and even utility payments, as well as to receive stimulus funds faster. Similarly, COVID-19 has transformed online shopping from a nice-to-have to a must-have around the world. Some bars in Beijing have even continued to offer happy hours through online orders and delivery. China has developed differently in terms of payment methods. While all countries have switched from cash to credit cards and now switching to mobile phones, China has skipped a step. The use of credit card in China is sporadic, if not non-existent. And even though mobile payment is overgrowing across the continent, Chinese people are using phone payments more often than their neighbors in Asia. There are four major companies in China. First is TenPay has the biggest market share by penetration rate in China with 84.3% in 2018, enveloped by Tencent company, WeChat Pay. Next is Alipay, is the only online payment system used in Taobao, which is the leading shopping website in China, owned by Alibaba. Then PayPal, entered into China in 2005 with services specifically designed for Chinese population, including Chinese entrepreneurs, to have better access to the international market with Baidu. PayPal and China UnionPay have also agreed to work together. Lastly, UnionPay is the world's largest payment card issuer with approximately 30% of cards worldwide being a China UnionPay card, CUP. So how does online payment work? There are two basic components of online payment, card authorization and transaction settlement. First, card authorization. This is the only step in the process in which your customer is directly involved. Essentially, your customer provides their credit card details, typically by filling out an online payment form that requests the name of the card type, the card number, the CVV. Before we continue further, let's test what you know. What Chinese social media app enveloped by Tencent Company has the biggest market share by penetration rate in China with 84.3% in 2018? If your answer is WeChat Pay, then you're correct. Thank you for your kind attention towards my prepared video clip. I would like to acknowledge my institution's president, Dr. Elizabeth Q. Lajos, the VPAA Dr. Rosalinda P. Valdepeñas, and the Dean of the SEA-ITE, Dr. Jonathan M. Caballero, for having me as a representative on the CIMEO Call for Lecture video clip for the team Innovative Lectures during COVID-19 pandemic. To God be the glory, God bless us all.
Okay, so we have learned so much about the topic on technological revolution in the post-COVID-19. So what is next, Piapa? Can you share with us?
That is very interesting. Lecture from Philippines, right? And now we walk you to Malaysia. And the next topic is about digital communication. And we have two interesting videos from Malaysia, from polytechnics institutions. And this lecture can be applied for other subjects as well, and such as like tourism mm-hmm. and also teacher education. Please enjoy this video.
So, are you ready to travel with me virtually? Let's get started. First, click on Google Chrome. Maximize and type here tour creator. This is how you're going to create first. And then click here tour creator. Here we are. We're going to travel the world by 360 degree virtual tour. Let's get started again. Okay, of course you need to sign in your Google Mail, as mine is here. Okay, here we are. So this is among the tour creator template that have been used. Okay, before we go forward, let's see one of the example that have been done here, which how we're going to travel the seven new wonder of the world. Let's publish it. Let me bring you first to the place before we create our own virtual tour using this tour creator. It will take a moment, but okay, when you're done, you can click view tour. Here we are. Now maximize so we can see by full screen. Did you know where are we now? We're now at the Taj Mahal, India. Okay, it's a very beautiful place. Alright, this is how it looks like when we be there. Okay, for your information, if you click on it, actually you can read information about the Taj Mahal itself. Okay, there are a few information about the Taj Mahal, the main gate. Here is the main gate. Where is the main gate? Here is the main gate. Alright, and then mausoleum. We have the garden. Okay, and then we have the mosque. Okay, so by travel 360 degree, you can see all this place without physically be there. Okay, if you want to travel next, you can click here next. Okay, now we at the Great Wall of China. So, are you ready to get your own virtual tour? Let's get started. Click on your tour. And then type the title. If you have some information about the place, put the description here. And then find the category. Okay, for cover photo, you can drop an image or select an image. Like me, I'm going to drop. Okay, done. Click create. Okay, this is the street view. So where you want to go? Okay, let me bring you to the Ephesus at Turkey. Here we are. This is the Ephesus Archaeological Museum. Okay, if you find satisfied with the picture, you can click on add scene. Okay, add scene here. So put the title scene. Here is a air business. Put some general information about the episodes. Okay, you can put the credit of the picture name here, and then if you want to put some the audio also can, and add the scenerization is also can. Now let me teach you how to add the point of interest, where when you point on it, there is some information. Okay, this is the add information. Like me, we're going to put here, this is the theater. Then type here what you want to do it. This is the theater. Okay, and OK. Okay, the teacher. And then put some information about it. Okay. Okay, done. If you have some audio, put it here. If you want to put some picture at the image, you can put over here also. Okay, we'll put one more information. I would like to put it here at the episodes library. Okay, this is the library of Celsius. Okay, done. If you want to put add-on more, feel free to do it. Use your own creativity. Don't limit yourself. For today, I just want to do it there. Finish. Okay, I just put one. If you want to put add-on, you can put here a scene, example, like you want to do, go to the Cappadocia, okay, Turkey. Okay, this is the computer Turkey. If you are very satisfied with the picture, you get add scene. Okay, so the what we say, the process still like previously, put the type, the title, and the description, and much more lah. Okay, so we are done. Then if you satisfied with that, you go to the publish and then click on publish, and you can see how the virtual look like. Okay, you can maximize it. So here are the scene that we just created just now. Okay, this is 360 view. So this is the library of Celsius, and this is the episodes data. Well, that's it. It's very easy, right? You can do your own virtual tour. Alright. Well, that's all my sharing about how to create a virtual tour using the tour creator that provided by the Google. Even though we are on pandemic COVID-19, I hope we still go travel, not physically, but virtually. Definitely, this virtual cannot replace the actual travel. But I hope when the pandemic is over, with this virtual experience, will inspire you to travel to the destination. For now, stay safe and see you then. Bye.
Hello. The use of WhatsApp, Facebook, and Instagram is nothing new. But the COVID-19 pandemic created an innovative nation. Look at the number of TikTok videos and how they involved celebrities, animals, babies, teenagers, adults, and even the elderly people. There was an increase in the use of social media through the use of videos and social media to entertain and educate others. So why stick to the traditional class presentations when you can use media as a flexible teaching and learning method? Let me share with you something that I make my students do even before the pandemic, and it is also appropriate as a post-pandemic teaching strategy. Broadcasting. As an English language teacher, we teach students vocabulary, grammar, and language skills in the formal classroom. We also create artificial settings and allow students to practice through role plays and presentations. But you can enhance this through broadcasting. It allows creativity, repetition, and error correction when there is a need, and it is also authentic. It allows students to explore and choose something they are familiar with. Of course, a kind of structure is required for them to follow and not randomly speak from the top of their heads. Input and technique need to be shared. For example, the balance coverage, which refers to the position of the speaker, the eye contact, and the looking room, which is the direction where the interviewee is looking at. And also, the over-shoulder recording, which allows focus on the interviewees, but the interviewer is still indirectly within the screen. For English, for example, I get students to report a place of interest or the best place to eat near the hometown or the landmark if they are on holiday, which takes approximately 2 minutes. However, students need to do a little bit of research on the location before doing the recording, the broadcasting, describing the chosen place. So, the lecturer has to be creative in coordinating this into the subject. The second part is the interview, teaching students to use WH questions in formulating questions is part of our syllabus. So activities in class allows students to familiarize themselves with the structure. The use of WH such as why, when, what will be used in the questioning. However, the interview with strangers allows them to put into practice their questioning techniques, listening skills, and how they respond to speakers. I believe this enhances the lifelong skill of being able to speak spontaneously.
The question is, can you use this with core subjects? Why not? I believe this is easily applicable to tourism students. Business students can broadcast themselves promoting a product and interviewing the public, asking them on views about the product. This strategy can also be used with engineering students. Students can be asked to present their final year project in a broadcasting video blog style, and the interviewee can be the consumer. Mechanical engineering students can be asked to disassemble the gear components of a motorcycle to explain the function and reassemble. Demonstration of cooking, promotion of chosen products, the process of servicing home air conditioning unit. So you see, broadcasting, video blogging and interviewing can easily be adopted and adapted as an output for the learning outcome. So look into flexible teaching and learning methodologies. Make lessons fun and interesting.
That is very interesting and new to me. So how do you feel about it, Rafi?
Well, it's very interesting, and what's more interesting are the comments from our YouTube participants, and we have almost 700 of them watching, and they appreciated the virtual travel, particularly during this time of pandemic where everything is on lockdown and it's very difficult to go around the country or even across the international border. So this is something that teachers, to the teachers on YouTube who are watching right now, they can utilize this in their lessons.
And they can apply for the other subjects as well.
Yes. And also, in that connection, they can also test the broadcasting as a teaching and learning method. So we have learned some very practical tips on how to conduct interviews, on how students can present their video assignments. So that is something that our participants can learn from.
Yes, that's right.
So let's now go to the next chapter. So after virtually going to Malaysia, now let's go to the Philippines and another presentation from Malaysia, this time on applied electronics. I'm sure most of our TVET participants, but also to the teachers and other educators, can learn from these videos about the signal system and a sensor-activated solar-powered hand-washing station. So let's enjoy these two lectures and learn from them.
Hello, awesome students. Welcome to Signal and System class. This is going to be an amazing, incredible lesson. First of all, let us introduce our group members. Our group members include Madam Raja Intan Zarina, Madam Rosaini, and Miss Noriana. And we are from Electrical Engineering Department of Tuanku Sultanah Bahia Polytechnic, Kedah, Malaysia. Here are the objectives that we are going to cover in this lesson. At the end of this lesson, students should be able to give a definition of signal, give a definition of system, and understand analog and digital signal. Are you ready, students? Let's enjoy our lesson. What is signal? Signal is a function representing a physical quantity, and signal must contain information about the behavior or nature of the phenomenon. Now, let's see what are examples of signals found around us. We have electrical signals that includes voltage and current, audio signal, light, telephone signal, computer signal, TV signal, and radio signal. Okay, students, now we look at what is the definition of system. System is a physical device that generates a response or output signal with a given input. Next, let's take a look at the examples of system exist around us. System that exists around us includes machines, engines, telephone system, TV set, audio amplifier, and water heater. Okay, students, now you have the basics of signal and system. Next, we look at what are the relationship between signal and system. Every system has one or more input. It is called excitation. Every system has one or more output, and it is called response. The inputs and outputs of the system are always signals. There are a variety of signals, but the most commonly used are analog and digital signal. Analog signal defines as continuous time signal that can take on any value in the continuous interval. Other than that, continuous time signals are signals of which its amplitude varies continuously with time. Okay, here are the examples of analog signal: human voice, electrical activity from heart and brain, signals flying from air such as Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, and radio, sea wave, and temperature from the thermometer. Next, we will go through a digital signal. Digital signal defines as a discrete time signal that can take only a finite number of distinct values. On the other words, discrete time signal has the amplitude that varies at every discrete values. These are the examples of digital signals: television, digital pen, mobile phone, Morse code, and computer. Finally, we are at the end of our lesson. So, what have you learned today? Please answer the following questions in order to test your understanding of our lessons. Let's try, students. In addition, we can generate a signal by using MATLAB application. Here are the example command to produce a continuous time signal. You can try on your own to see the result. Is the simulation result. Did you get the same result as mine? Good luck, guys. Okay, students, this is the end of our class. Hope you enjoyed the lesson. Thank you and have a nice day.
From Guimara State College. I am about to discuss the sensor-activated, solar-powered hand-washing station under the theme Technology and the sub-theme Technological Revolution in the Post-COVID-19. COVID-19 has infected more than 16 million people all over the world and has claimed almost 650,000 lives. Its mode of transmission is initially identified through aerosol droplets. These infected droplets can enter the body through inhalation, or through the eyes, or through dirty hands touching the face, especially the mouth. What are the most common symptoms of this disease? The most common symptoms is fever, dry cough, and tiredness, just like the common colds. The less common symptoms include aches and pains, sore throat, diarrhea, headache, loss of taste, a rash on the skin or discoloration in the fingers or toes. And the serious symptoms include difficulty in breathing, chest pain, loss of speech or movement. As of now, there is no known cure for this disease. Authorities emphasize on prevention methods to inhibit the spread of the virus. These prevention steps are wearing a mask, practice social distancing, and practice proper hand sanitation. There are two ways we can sanitize our hands: through alcohol-based hand sanitizers and by washing our hands with soap and water. Many public places, such as malls, schools, government offices, and churches, have installed hand-washing stations for such purposes. The common hand-washing practices uses faucet and hand soap. The downside of this practice is that the general public is using this facility and you have no idea whether the person who used the facility before you is infected by the virus or not, since majority of COVID-19 cases are asymptomatic. And you will be touching the same surfaces, increasing the risk of contracting the virus. Here in the Philippines, our province, the Guimaras Island, known for its beautiful beaches and the home to the sweetest mangoes in the world, is blessed to maintain zero local infection cases of COVID-19. And we are desperate to maintain that record because we are just a small province and our capabilities in handling such situation is still very limited. With this in mind, in Guimaras State College, a premier higher education institution in Guimaras, a group of technical people from the GSC Industrial Technology Research and Development Center and College of Engineering and Industrial Technology developed a hand-washing station. Current designs of hand-washing stations are mostly stationary. Its water source is connected by a tube to the main source. It uses a faucet in dispensing water, and the soap is either a bar soap or liquid soap inside a bottle with pump dispensing mechanism. This method makes the user touch many surfaces, and the risk of contracting the virus is quite high. To eliminate the probability of contracting the virus through any parts of the hand washing station, GSC developed sensor-activated solar-powered hand washing station. With this hand washing station, you don't need to touch anything. You just stand there, hold your hand out, and let the machine do the washing for you. Aside from being sensor-activated, it is also solar-powered and environmentally sustainable. The machine houses its own power source, control system, water dispensing system, soap dispensing system, hand dryer, and gray water collector in one body. It is portable and easily transported anywhere you like with a pickup truck. It is also efficient with water consumption as the machine uses proximity sensors and is activated only when it detects the user. The gray water collected can be processed into its useful form again, thus conserving our water resources. The warm air from the hand dryer will eliminate the need for towels, which could be a risk for contamination. During this pandemic season, it is important to maintain clean hands. And hand washing station has become a necessity in almost every public places. This is the hand washing machine. This is the sink. This is the faucet, the soap dispenser, and the hand dryer. The moment you use the faucet, an indicator light will turn on, indicating that the faucet is in use. Same goes with the soap dispenser. And same goes with the hand dryer. So basically, that is how the machine works. This machine, when mass-produced, will be applicable to entrances of public places such as hospitals, local government offices, quarantine facilities, schools, offices, markets, churches, ports, transportation terminals, and almost anywhere. With this innovation, hand washing will be made more convenient and available to the masses, leading to a significant reduction of transmission of the virus in the long run. Though a vaccine is yet to be discovered for this new threat that the world is facing, humanity's only weapon to fight this seemingly invisible war is through prevention and a strong immune system. This is Mary Elizabeth Pareño, and thank you for your time. Stay safe, and God bless us all.
Okay, so there we have it, Tia Pa. So before you introduce the next chapter, we have some questions on our YouTube on how they can access these materials that we have showcased today.
Right. They can visit the SEA-Teacher website, www.seamio.org, and then you will see the big banner in front of our homepage, and they click in the banner on the lecture series, and then you can see the list of the video.
Yes.
And then the individual video will be shown to you, and then you can download and reuse for your teaching and learning materials.
Yes. So we learned so much in this chapter. So what's next, Tiapa?
Well, the next chapter is a little bit too technical, but however, we have three videos from two from Malaysia and one from the Indonesia, and it's about the engineering survey, automated, and pattern marking. But the point is, I want the teachers to see that how they can transform the very technical knowledge and make the people to understand the difficult subject within a few minutes. That is the hint. So let's see the video, how they can make the technical subject to be easy for everyone.
Welcome to the second year automotive technology. Dear all students, I have sent the learning material to you at our learning management system platform. I'm sure you have learned the material as prerequisite. Well, now let us discuss comprehensively about all nine sensors. The first one is camshaft position sensor. Next, crankshaft position sensor. Next, throttle position sensor. And last but not least is vehicle speed sensor. Well, student, theoretically, as mentioned in our learning goal, the student should understand about the function of automobile sensors. To make clear, this class is divided into three groups to do practice. One is dealing with the vehicle, one learn in our lab, and one is doing home the project. Let's go.
In this job, students will learn about automotive sensors in the vehicle. The first, to find out the sensors in the vehicle.
Please mask eye for sensor.
Next, to check the sensors and the connectors. And then, to diagnose the sensor with a Sitronic scanner.
Hello student, welcome to this lab. After online learning through our learning management system, this student must explore the sensor. These activities are required to support and to prove the information that they have before, especially information that they have from our learning management. Thank you, student. In the next rotation, stay healthy.
Hello, everyone. Thank you that all students already sent to me the technical drawings work assignment. In here, I would like to check the result. First, I will check the collection of assignment. Second, I will check the suitability of the sensor. Part drawings, we can see all part here. Third, this is 3D assembly drawings. And also, the animation is great. And I hope you all understand the description of drawings. I think the technical drawing is also complete. And thank you for everyone.
Dear all students, I am Brian as instructor of automotive technology. Thank you for your cooperation during the course. Before we come to the end, I will conduct a session of evaluation online. Please work out your tests within 1 hour. Thank you for your attention and see you in the other topics.
Casting is an engineering manufacturing process generally used for mass production, in which materials in a molten state are poured into a mold cavity where they solidify. The cavity is created by the utilization of a pattern, generally made of wood or metal that is of the same shape and dimensions as the actual part. The most common types of casting are sand casting, die casting and casting wax. A pattern is a model or the replica of the object to be cast. Material for making a pattern are from wood, metal, plastic, plaster and wax. A pattern prepares a mold cavity for the purpose of making a casting. To make a pattern we need 2 pieces of wood, sandpaper, glue, wood filler, tools for measuring, G-clamp, handsaw, and file. Step 1. Cut the wood into 2 different pieces according to the dimension. Marked it by using steel ruler or vernier caliper pencil and compass. Step 2. Cut the workpiece according to the shape that are given by handsaw. Use G-clamp to hold the workpiece. Step 3. Place the workpiece and device and do the finishing by using wood files. To get the right shape, the workpiece having a round shape or curve must be properly fisted. Step 4. To get a strong bond, the work piece should be in glue, and then clamp using G-clamp within a certain period. Step 5. To get the wood surfaces more smooth and neat, use sandpaper. Step 6. To remove sharp corners, fill fillets in order by wood filler. And the last step are, sand the pattern again and give shellac coating.
Okay, Piapa, we've learned so much, and also our participants, the more than 600, 700 participants with us on YouTube, and they're very interested with the topics, with the lectures that were previously presented, particularly on the one about the virtual tour.
All right, okay. What is the website of the virtual tour? I think that there are many participants asking about how to access to the website again.
Yes, the website, you can just launch your Google as instructed during the video and just type tour creator. And it will lead you to the page where Ms. Zakia, the presenter from Polytechnic Tuanku Syed Sirajuddin, Malaysia. Where she accessed that tour creator.
Oh, that's good.
Okay. And also, we also have lots of comments about the presentation from Guimaras State College on the
The hand washing,
the automatic. So
yeah, interesting and innovative. We don't need to touch anything, just put the hand there, and then the machine will wash our
automatically.
Hand great.
So now that we've learned so much from blended learning for mechanics, applied electronics, so what's next? The next part would be on the augmented reality.
This is a very highly technical subject again.
Yes, but you will see when we watch the lecture how they were able to digest it into something that is easily understandable by all of us, particularly for our learners who will benefit from these lectures.
Yes, that's right.
So we have two presenters from Malaysia, two lecturers. So let's learn from these lectures.
Assalamualaikum. I'm Marianti binti Mat Soat from Mechanical Engineering Department. Today, I want to share with you all about the Magnetic Augmented Reality Training Kit. This training kit uses HP Reveal to simulate 10 set of exercises from single cylinder circuit to multi-cylinder circuit. Okay, now I will demo how to use this training kit using AR for the first exercise. Now I will show to you for the exercise number 5 from you.
Switch.
Literacy initiative to my students in understanding about the basic initiative, mentally and practical activities. This training kit already received recognition as the best mechanical project award and gold medal for Syrian International Invention, Innovation and Technology Expo 2019.
DCQ 10043, Building Works Measurement 1, is a course provides students knowledge on the development and the importance of quantitative surveying profession globally. For this video clip, substructure item under work below lowest floor finish building elements has been chosen as the main topic under this course. Bed foundation is the item under the work below lowest floor finish element. As we know, pad foundation used to support individual or multiple columns, spreading the load to the ground below for a building. Therefore, as a quantitative surveyor, they must know the basic items under the pad foundation in order to do pricing estimate. For this topic, quantity surveying student must know the items of substructure, the anatomy of pad foundation and pad foundation according to the standard method of the measurement 2, SMM2, for the student to take off quantity by preparing taking off list and do the measurement of the components of pad foundation and pricing it. Pandemic COVID-19, online classes has been conducted by using technology based on augmented reality AR. Students can understand and visualize the true form of the pad foundation. This can indirectly attract students to learn this subject more effectively. At the same time, students can also find out the elements found in the pad foundation. With augmented reality learning, it also helps to improve students' cognitive, psychomotor, and affective levels indirectly.
This COVID-19, we must change our learning styles with this online platform. And to me, it's quite convenient and very useful. So since it will actually give us the AR file for helpful thing, and it's quite helpful for me to understand the place and the use of that foundation.
This online class is very useful and actually useful to all people because knowledge is unlimited, so you have no excuse to search or learn about a new thing. Like we just learned before about pad footing or pad foundation, it uses more variation of style to make the student more understand. So it's a very interesting and fun to learn in this online class.
So online classes is the best platform that we have no reason to learn about more thing. Even though we are not in the class, we have another way to contact each other. Stay safe, stay happy, keep learning.
#KitaJagaKita
Okay, so we've learned so much about augmented reality, and we have questions about from our participants talking about how can they contact our speakers, Piata?
Well, they can check the presentation again after this session finished by log into the YouTube again, and then they can review the email address of the presenter at the end of their own presentation. And then they can contact them directly for the additional information, how they can, you know, make use of the software program or materials that has been shown by the lecturers.
Or if they want to partner.
Yes, sure.
Learn more about the technology, about the innovation that they have shared, you may do so by contacting them directly, as they have freely shared their email addresses at the end of their videos.
That's right.
So now, Piapa, we're down to the last chapter.
Yes.
So can you introduce our lecturers?
Well, this next chapter is more related to our life because it's about the modern agriculture. And these lectures are, one is from Philippines about the oyster mushroom production, and another one from Indonesia about urban farming. So for this lecture, you will see that the content is very comprehensive and practical, and it's very easy for everyone to follow and learn about the agriculture. So let's enjoy the videos.
Mushroom is a type of fungi that is comparable to vegetables because this is rich in vitamins, proteins, and minerals. Mushrooms are being grown indoor. One of the advantages is that we will not have any problem in times of typhoon seasons, because most of the problem of our plants occurs during this time. Meanwhile, mushrooms are being grown inside a mushroom growing house where the temperature is easily managed. So what are the benefits of mushrooms? One of the thorough studies done at Central Luzon State University and Central Bicol State University of Agriculture is the zero-waste technology of rice straw. Generally, rice straw is locally abundant in the Bicol region, Philippines, where it is commonly burned after use. Mushroom has two processes or life stages of its life cycle. First is the micro stages of its life cycle. However, we need a microscope to observe the morphological structure of the fungi. The second is the macro stage where the harvestable fruiting bodies occur. In the Philippines, we have cultivated different kinds of mushrooms. The most common is the oyster mushroom. It is the most prolific and nutritious kind of mushroom that is suitable for the tropical climate of the Philippines. Aside from this, we also have indigenous mushrooms scientifically known as the Schizophyllum communae, which can also be found in the Philippines. It is commonly known as Kurakding by Bicol, Pudit in Ilocano, and Siklot in Quezon provinces. Furthermore, the mushroom has therapeutic activity or benefits like antibacterial, anti-inflammatory, antioxidant, anti-tumor, and many more. In eating mushroom, you can get two benefits. First, as food, and second, as a medicine directly received by your body. Other than this, mushrooms also have indirect benefits. For instance, the utilized substrate in mushroom cultivation can be converted into organic fertilizer, which can give better results to our plants. Most of the substrates utilized in mushroom production is generally the waste of the agro-industrial community. As to make a tissue culture like this, all we need is the coconut water, wherein it will serve as the media for the production of our mother tissue culture. The materials that we need are inoculating needle, a scalpel, and alcohol lamp. So we need to get the fresh piece of mushroom, cut it into two. A small piece of mushroom in between the stipe and the pilus. We obtain this because this is the actively dividing cells of the fungi, and then aseptically inoculate it in the center of a sterile petri plate. This will take approximately 2 weeks to fully colonize the media. The mycelial block of the mother culture will be aseptically inoculated in the center of the newly sterile basal grains. This will take 3 weeks to fully ramify the grains. By then, each single grain contains the cell line of the mushroom that will be used in planting to the fruiting buds. The ideal fruiting bud combination are 7-part rice straw, 3-part sawdust, and 1-part rice bran. The appropriate moisture of the substrate is 65% moisture content. So to attain it, you need to get a handful of this and squeeze it. And if there is no leak of water, and when you drop it and it is still intact, it means that the 65% of moisture was attained. Subsequently, the substrate will be placed in a 7x14 polypropylene bag. Each fruiting bud must not be less than 1 kilogram on substrate. Afterwards, place a 3/4 PVC as neck and seal it with a cotton waste. Cotton was being utilized since it allows the enter of air and prevent the entry of microorganisms that can contaminate the substrate. After this, the fruiting buds will be pasteurized for a period of 6 to 8 hours. In inoculation of the mycelial carrier of the mushroom, which is the grain spore, the initial step will be to sanitize the area with 70% alcohol. Then, sterilize the inoculating needle by flaming it until red hot. Allow it to cool, then gently sludge the grain and aseptically inoculate it to the pasteurized fruiting bugs. The newly inoculated fruiting bugs will take 3 to 4 weeks to fully colonize by the mushroom. Once it is completely ramified, the fruiting bodies of mushroom will arise. In in 3 to 5 days, floating bodies are ready for harvest.
To urban farming. I am Hetty, the lecturer of Agriculture Faculty of UPN Veteran Yogyakarta in Indonesia. This is urban farming. Simple put, urban farming is growing or producing food in the cities. Benefits and advantages of urban farming are fulfilling quality food need, creating jobs especially for housewife, increasing consumption of fresh fruits and vegetables, good for the body and mental health because plant can be used for therapy, creating a healthy environment and nice view. There are many methods of urban farming which you can do. The first, verticulture, the second, hydroponics, the third, aquaponics, and the fourth, well gardening. Making seedlings and nursery. This is Pagoda Master. Mix planting media using latex, compost, and soil. Then put it into polybag. Before planting, make a planting hole with a depth of 5 cm. Then cover it with soil. How to make organic fertilizer? Pick the old leaves. You can put it into the container. After 3 weeks, organic fertilizer can be applied for a plant.
Then, of course, vegetable. This is no chemical combined and no pesticide.
Salad in hydroponic system. Starting salad seedling for NFT hydroponic. Put the salad bulb on the rock wool. When you see soot, transplant into NFT channels and fertilize until the salad reaches harvestable size. The first culture with aquaponic. First day, wash bucket, smear it with papaya leaves, fill water into the bucket until 3/4 of bucket. Second day, mix with probiotics plus molasses, put it into the bucket. It is hushed up until 7 days. 7 days, plant the kale in the pot using wood charcoal media. Hang it on the edge of the bucket. This This baby catfish put plastic that contain baby catfish into bucket under 10 minutes. Open plastic and put baby catfish in the water. Feed catfish every morning and evening. The kill can be harvested 4 to 5 times. This is small gardening. There are many kinds of vegetable can be planted in the wall planter bag, such as spinach, lettuce, mustard, kale, and extra. My last word, organic vegetable cultivation is badly need to develop. It can support for food security. My opinion, urban farming can be the forefront in the food systems. Thank you for your attention.
Wow, that's very interesting. I wish after I watching this one to have my own small urban farm in my house so I can, you know, feed the catfish and grow some vegetables. So for the participants who would like to get more information about the lectures, you can visit to our www.simeo.org website. And again, you click on the banner. And there are many lectures that have not been shown or presented in this session, but still available for you to see and learn about it.
Yes, all you guys need to do is to check on our website and then click all those videos, all the video resources.
The banner of the lecture series.
So I think that concludes the third SEA-Teacher-TVET lecture series for this Thursday. And we thank all our speakers, all our lecturers, all 14 of them. Thank you so much for sharing your knowledge and information with our participants.
Yes, that's right.
At this point, you recall that we asked for reflections for your testimonials the previous week, and we have shared with you some testimonials before the start of this lecture series. Now let's look at some of the testimonials from you.
In essay writing.
Yes, so these are the submitted reflections, testimonials from us. We have from Vietnam. So he mentioned the useful tools that were shared in the previous lecture series.
Yes. And one from Philippines. So she took the photo when she watched the lecture series. By mobile phone.
Yes, and she talks about online teaching and learning. And we also have another one from Pangasinan in the Philippines, in the northern part. And she talks about the information and the instruments and opportunities and the positivity. From our lecture series. So thank you for that.
And this is another good picture capture from our participants that she just want to show us that while we provide the lecture, she's still downloading the poll everywhere, which are suggested by one of our lecturers.
And then we have one from Albay in the Philippines, and he shared with us the positive, respectful relationship to others and appreciation of the diversified culture and history. So thank you for that. So we're still requesting you, all our participants on YouTube, we have 631 joining us today, to submit to us your reflections, your testimonials on how you benefited, how you're able to use, or for example, we have learned so much today, the tool creator or about the innovations that you've encountered or the TVET, particularly on the engineering, augmented reality. So we want to know how you're able to use it in your own classrooms. So please submit to us a video clip or an essay, half page A4 with your photos, and email it to us at webinar@simio.org. And please include your contact details, your full name, position, institution, address, country, and email address in your email to us. Yes. So as I have mentioned, these are the third, and next week will be the fourth and the last. So Piapa, what shall we be expecting next week?
Well, next week, the theme is smart business and hospitality in the new normal. Again, the same time on the next Thursday, 27 at 10 to 11:30 Bangkok time, we have 12 innovative lectures from Indonesia, Philippines, and Malaysia. And the highlights for next week, including like new trends in business and hospitality and tourism, digital marketing and product development, and also innovative teaching for business and hospitality. Next slide. And again, we invite all the participants from the university, TVET students and teachers, and no need for the pre-registration. And this is the link for you to view the for the next week's session. And again, and if you want to have like additional information, you can email us to webinar@simio.org. And this is the banner on our website that if you would like to have like additional information, you just click this banner after you visiting our website, and then you will see the session in order. If you click on the teacher education session, you will see all the video related to the teacher education. If you click on the technology, you will see all video related to the technology. So the video of the technology today will be uploaded on our website by today. So you can access more video on technology by tomorrow. Okay, how we get e-certificate of the participation, Rafi?
Yes, that's a burning question in our live YouTube session. So how will you get the e-certificate of participation? So you only have 11 hours to fill it up. The link is now active and the deadline is 11 o'clock hours. This is Bangkok time. You can see the QR code on the left side of the screen. And if you have inquiries about the certificate, please use this email certificate@simio.org. So you just need to fill out the certificate validation form after watching this session. Please ensure that your full name and email addresses are correct before submission, as we are using an automated system in generating the certificate. So we will not be able to fix your certificate as soon as we send it to you. And please give us 1 month to process the certificates. Again, we're thanking everyone for joining us. Tiapa, let's say goodbye to them and we will see them again next week.
See you again next week, and thank you for your participation in our session today, and thank you for all contributions from the lecturers who submit the video clips and join in this program. Thank you everyone.
Thank
Bye-bye.
You so much, and a pleasant morning to everyone.
By promoting knowledge and policies, we can build a better world.